onto the pop scene in the 1990s and going on to sell over 10 million records. The original Atomic Kitten Girls are back together. But is it for good? Let's find out. It's Kerry, Natasha and Liz, Atomic Kitten.
Jazz hands!
Jazz hands! How are you, ladies?
Really good.
Good. Looking very glamorous today. Yeah, really nice.
And there's me on the end. All right!
Sorry. She looks cool, very rock chick. I'm loving your vibe today. Now, is it weird being back together, or is it sort of like being back in the past?
I think it's weird because it's like part-time pop stars. Because we literally like come in, we do a bit of work, and then we're like, see you next week. And we all go home to like the kids and other bits of work.
Yeah.
And then it's a bit weird at the moment, isn't it?
I'll be honest, I think it feels like, I mean, when we were doing the intense rehearsals for the show, it was great, but then we've had this big break and I've gone off to do my thing, Tasha's doing hers, Liz is doing hers,
yeah,
and we're all doing our own separate things, and then this is the first time we've seen each other since...
Is it three weeks?
No, we've done something before then.
Did we?
Yeah, a week.
Yeah, we can't remember when we saw it. we're not seeing each other on a regular basis.
Compared to back in the day when it was literally like 24 hours a day, it's now a week.
Yeah.
I think this works better. Actually, we're friends.
But actually, there's a good point in that because you actually can keep a little bit of sanity. You know, you just keep it.
It's
more
not
friendly.
All about the band and being harassed with work.
It's nice having your little thing and going home to your normal cleaning and ironing. And
like you clean and iron.
I swear to God, I really do.
Don't tie my housekeeper.
Now, girls, you were teenagers when you first started out. So did you realise what you were letting yourselves in for? That young.
No, but in both, in a positive way and a negative way. It was better than we could ever have imagined, but also, you know, scarier than you can imagine too.
Yeah.
And a lot of pressure.
Yeah, nothing can... nothing can compare you.
No, prepare you!
To speak.
I swear I haven't had a drink.
The bar.
Nothing can prepare you for the intensity and the just scrutinizing.
I just noticed your kitten ears.
Yeah!
Oh, yeah!
They are cute.
Yeah, nothing can prepare you. It's mental, it's full on, it's constant touring, constant talking, constant.
Anyway,
crazy.
So Tasha isn't with us today.
It's been a long day.
Yeah, for me, it was amazing, and I just thought, you know, if we get this record deal, my life will be perfect. Yeah. And it didn't kind of work out that way. As much as I love performing with the girls and getting the free clothes and my makeup, it does wear thin after a little while, doesn't it? Especially when
I'm loving it again, though.
Yeah, it is nice.
I've got the little bit of I've got the passion back.
You've got the buzz back.
Yeah.
But you also feel bad as well, is that when that doesn't become like a novelty, you think, God, well, that's really bad.
Yeah,
it's really bad.
Definitely.
So I think it's good to take a break and come back to something.
And we're a lot older and wiser, and we can kind of take it for what it is.
Oh, we're just older.
Definitely not wiser. Not
I think you are. You've matured. You know what you're doing this time round.
Yeah.
You know what it's about.
Me and Kess, we're doing it for the kids as well.
Exactly. You've got families.
Yeah, it's great to kind of have that reason to do it for and.
Definitely. Now, your first three singles, Right Now, See Ya and I Want Your Love, were all top 10 hits. What did you feel at the time? Like, those three singles doing really well on the charts.
I'll never forget the first single, Right Now, and I think we was on a train, wasn't we?
Really?
Yeah, we was on a train, Right Now. Not on the video, when we found out you went to number 10. And I think you wasn't with us, but me and you went back to my mum's one-bedroom council flat.
Oh, I'll tell you where I was. I was stuck in the broom cupboard at LFC. We did the day our song charted. We sang a half time at the pitch at Anfield. These two left early. My car never came, and the countdown was on the radio, and I was crying. So the janitor said, "Come and listen to it on the radio in my little cupboard." And I sat in his cupboard, surrounded by bleach and mops, listening on my own. Didn't even get home.
Oh, the glamour!
The glamour
of being an Atomic Kitten.
Yeah, we went back to my mum's one-bedroom council flat, didn't we? And had it on the radio, and we'd be
dancing.
it? Oh, no, he started crying. Helen Knox filmed it.
They showed that on Thursday.
Did they? Did they?
And I said, oh, I was stuck in a broom cupboard. And then the next day, Alfie went, Mummy, broom cupboard?
Now, despite having those three hits, it was widely reported that you girls were going to be dropped by your record label after your single Follow Me stalled at number 20. So what was the truth in that? Were they literally going to drop you?
That was the truth, but we didn't know at the time. Our management kept it from us and said, well, basically, they begged them, please, just give them one last chance. And they did.
Well, because they knew Hole Again was, you know, a pretty big hit, you know, sort of the big wigs were like, this is going to be really good, it's going to be really good. So they just said, just do this last one. And then that's
like the minimum budget ever.
Yeah.
It was great, though, because it was all done on a shoestring budget, so we recouped everything that we'd kind of borrowed off the record label, which was great.
Now, so one more single was released, A Last Gasp at the Straw, and out of nowhere, with no real airplay, Hole Again went to number one. It was a pop miracle. You couldn't have expected that.
Well, to be honest, we toured that song for 2 years. We always sang it in our set, and every time we'd sing it, literally by chorus two, everyone would be singing the words back. So we knew that
you
song had something. It was like, this is special.
Yeah, it was good.
So were you involved in telling the label, look, just give us one more try,
no,
can we?
No, not at all. No, I think by that point as well, before we even knew it was going to get dropped, I dropped another big bombshell on the girls and said, look, girls, I'm not out. I went out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Hole Again was originally spoken. Like, Kerry spoke the song. And then at the last minute, they put a melody in it. And kind of just made the song the hit it is, really.
So let's chat about Hole Again. Kerry, you mentioned before, you left the band literally just before the track went to number one. You must have been gutted.
No. Wasn't bitter at all. No, I was made up for the girls. I really was.
Yeah.
I hadn't been enjoying it for a long time, not because of the girls. It didn't crack up to be what I thought it was going to be. I had a lot of problems at home as well at the time. And I was about to give birth to my biggest number one today, my baby Molly, so...
Aww.
But she did tell me on the sly, oh, by the way, I'm leaving, but don't tell anyone. And I was like...
Oh my God.
You can't put this pressure on me.
Yeah. I told you I was pregnant, and you just went, baby gap. Do you remember?
We go to baby gap.
Baby gap. I said, don't say it, but I'm pregnant. Yeah, they go.
Oh. Wow. And Kerry, what was it like seeing your replacement, Jenny Frost, sort of singing the lyrics to your number one single?
I'll be honest with you. I didn't really watch. You know, I was in the middle of moving from England to Ireland and getting set up over there and getting ready to give birth. You know, I was just ready to get married and have my first baby. So that was the more important. I mean, the girls came to see me. Yeah, the girls came to see me, and Jenny and Carl, our tour manager, and obviously I haven't been watching what the girls have been doing, except when we caught up, and they came to my house, and Carl was like, right, come on, Kerry, hair and makeup, and I was like, that was the first time I felt real jealousy of the girls being rushed off the feet and going into hair and makeup and being on the go. I kind of thought, God, I really miss you girls, and then they all left the drive and waved goodbye, and I was like...
Oh.
And I think I cried for about a week, and my mum was there, and I was like, I'm just dead lonely here in Ireland, and I've got no friends.
Oh. But on a high note, anyway, for the rest of the girls, it went on to become one of the best pop singles of all time. It stayed at number one in the UK for 4 weeks, and then went to number one in 18 countries 19 countries around the world, which is crazy. Now, what was it like suddenly becoming international pop stars just weeks after you faced the chop?
Brilliant.
I think it was
yeah, was it a slap in the face of the guys who were like...
It was brilliant because before that, we used to get shipped off to, like, Europe and stay in these, like, one-star hotels that were frightening. And they wouldn't have any room service, so you'd be working all day, you'd come home, they'd be like, no food, so we'd be starving and in a bit of a dump. And then all of a sudden, it was five-star. I was like, yeah, we get to eat!
I know. It was totally insane as well, because I think there was a lot of... I think because we beat U2 to number one as well, that sort of
at
the time.
I like how you got that in there.
Yeah, I just had to say that, thank you. And it came with a lot of sort of kudos almost, really.
Yeah.
Everyone was a bit like, wow.
Well, we kind of had Bono coming up to us going, oh, we've kicked the out of rock.
Ah.
I think he said bit the arm.
Yeah, and then you kind of got like the Gallagher brothers going, yeah, right, give us a hug and all that. at the Enemy Awards.
So Atomic people Kitten, were loving you after that number one, weren't
it
they?
Was brilliant. I think, you know, it's just, it was obviously it really put us on the map, and it was just, things just changed completely overnight.
And how did you celebrate that kind of success? Were you staples on the showbiz party scene after that? Were you invited to the parties?
We had a party.
We had a number one party, yeah.
We did. Where was that?
It was in the centre of London.
In Leicester Square there? I remember.
And you could see all Leicester Square. It's really, really cool. But you know what's weird about things?
Yeah, I didn't invite you.
Well, you have the chart, it's fine. You were relaxing.
I just say that all with my Iceland products and a buffet on my own.
But you know what's weird? I was just going to say, you know what's weird about things like that is that there were so many... You know what I found strange initially is that there were so many people there at that party that I did not have a clue they were. And I just thought... But they didn't work with us or anything because we knew everyone we worked with and who promoted it for us and everything. But some people, you know, people who just sort of come along with that mega fame.
You get those people. They had you doubted you, and they're like, oh yeah, I always believed you. Yeah, whatever.
Yeah. You have those sort of
Klingons.
Yeah, exactly. Klingons that come running. You're like, wait a minute, what are you doing here? Now, so much happened to all of you girls so far. So, did you have a chance to really take it in and appreciate what was going on at the time, or?
I feel like I did. I feel like I really lived the dream. I loved every single minute of it, and it was just grateful. Mm.
No, but that's, I think that's my reason for coming back, is that, because obviously the girls said that, you know, that it's really nice for their kids to see them, but I don't have children. Mm. So for me, because I don't think I appreciated it enough, I think I would like to pay more attention to everything.
What did you all enjoy the most about being in Atomic Kitten? If you can have, like, one highlight.
Free clothes.
That's pretty good. That is pretty good.
Travelling the world.
Yeah, just having the opportunity to perform on some mega stages like Party in the Park or the Queen's Golden Jubilee.
Yeah.
The school tours.
I think I'd say free clothes is pretty awesome.
It's not bad getting free clothes constantly and not having to buy any of that. Yeah. That's good, good times. Now, Kerry and Natasha, you both have children. Now, are they old enough to twig onto the fact that their mums used to be pop stars?
Yeah. And my eldest, Josh, who's 10, the other day I said, oh, you're going to come and you're looking forward to the concert in London? He went, not really, Mum. You see, it's not my kind of music. I'm into Tiny Temper and Adele. And I went, who are you now? You're not coming.
And was he silent after that?
He was just like, sorry, Mum, but you're just not cool enough for me. And I was devastated. He's coming whether he likes it or not.
Yeah. I've got my little godson, actually, Jake. He keeps getting really upset that I'm on TV and he can't reach me, can't get me.
Oh.
So every time he goes to bed at night, apparently he's going, no one is, no one is.
Oh.
So that's cute. That's
what about your girls?
I gave it up before they was even born, but my elders, they all know that, you know, they've seen mummy on TV all the time. You know, they're excited. I actually brought my Lily, my second eldest. I've got that many kids, I can't keep up. My second eldest to the rehearsals.
Oh, cool.
And I said to her, I went, so was you like, oh my God, that's my mum? She went, no. I was like, oh my God, that's my mum. You were so much better than what I expected. She was amazing.
Oh.
And I was like, oh, baby girl, because they've never seen me perform or sing. And, you know, they were really made up. So
that's cute.
Yeah.
Do you find them singing along to any of your songs?
Well, actually, I've just moved and the two girls were in their bedroom doing a routine to Hole Again,
which
is great.
Yeah, the boys all know. Even Alfie knows the songs now.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
He sings Hole Again.
She forces the music on them.
Listen to
it. We have it on constant loop in our house.
I think that's right.
Why not? You've got to, you know, be proud of your Atomic Kitten background, your song.
Definitely proud of our achievements.
Yeah, definitely. Now Atomic Kitten have some excellent original songs, but you also covered some classics and did them justice, by the way, ladies. Some absolute tunes. We're talking Eternal Flame, The Tidy's High and Ladies' Night. So did you actually choose those covers to record?
No, we didn't. There were all suggestions, and actually we were all a bit like, really? We're going to do a cover?
Do you remember when we got sent Blondie's version of The Tidy's High and it was like, that like little trumpet was a bit reggae, and we were like, what, Atomic Kitten do reggae now? And this is weird. And they were like, no, it's just an idea. You know, it's the song, we're going to change it. And we changed it to The Tidy's High. Get the feeling.
And then with the tin of flame, I think we were more scared about changing something such a massive song.
I literally was in that vocal booth because when you do like the kids the big note, and I was like, I can't do it.
Choking up.
I can't do it. And they were like, you can. And it just kind of come out, and I was like, it's great.
And I was doing a Rockabye Baby by Black Sheep and Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, but I had no problems with them.
They were her covers, yeah. It's fine. Now, in 2004, though, you called Time an Atomic Kitten. So why was that decision made?
I'd not long had Josh, and I got postnatal depression, but I didn't really talk about any, and it left untreated for so long that it really just kind of all got a bit too much and just needed to step back from it all and just be a mum, really. So I would have loved to carry on, but we weren't really given the opportunity to have an extended break. It wasn't like I'll have a year off and come back. Mm. No one really was.
I was actually in the jungle, and the message got to me while I was in the jungle doing Amber Slabs to get me out of here that Atomic Kitten had broken up.
No.
Really?
Yeah, because all the families was able to send letters in. Do you remember? You'll get a letter, and Brian at the time wrote to me, said, just to let you know, Atomic Kitten, it's a sad day, Atomic Kitten has split up, I thought you should know.
That was sarcasm, wasn't it? It's a sad day, Atomic Kitten have ended.
It might have been, I know, it was really sad. I was like, what a shame, and I was like, but I thought it was ironic that I was in the jungle on the other side of the world in Australia.
Crazy.
And I found out that it had been announced.
There you go. Yeah. We went, surprise, we went, see ya. Yeah.
But another thing as well about that is that, you know, when Kez said she was going to leave, we weren't ready to take time out or take a break or anything like that.
We weren't ready to lose her, by the way. Yeah, you know, absolutely. It was our time. You know, she was like our big sister.
Was it, you just literally went your separate ways to go and do what you want to do. Obviously, you went to do your mum duties. Yeah. You wanted to do other stuff. So it was a nice ending, wasn't it? It didn't sort of, there wasn't any...
Well, to an extent, but we did actually take quite a bit of time away from each other.
Yeah, we just were like...
For a while. We did actually go our separate ways properly.
Oh, really? Yeah. And not speak?
Well, yeah, I think we needed that time to just, like, almost, like, de-stress, you know.
I think it's always tough when one person makes a decision to say, look, I need to call it a day, I can't carry on, because you're taking that job away from someone else. So I think we were all kind of, you know, emotions were running high. It was a tough time for everyone. It was a tough time for the girls to say goodbye to Atomic Kitten, and obviously tough for me with what I was going through. So we kind of all went our separate ways, give each other the space that we needed. And then I think I got pregnant a couple of months later, and that brought us all back together again. Mm. So like all girls, we had our ups and downs, but fundamentally, you know, we are great friends and we're still friends today.
So now the original lineup is back together, but almost original, because wasn't it true that Heidi Range the Sugar Babes was in the original lineup? No,
not in Atomic Kitten.
It was called like Honey Heads or something.
Really?
Yeah, it was myself, Liz, and Heidi, and Heidi left. And that was it. And, you know, 4 weeks later, we got Natasha. No, it wasn't even 4 weeks. We got Natasha. 4 weeks later, we got a record deal. So it was kind of like, no, Heidi. But she went on to go into Sugar Babes, which was brilliant.
So, there we go. So obviously, you're back in the band now, Kerry. So are you hoping to turn the tables on Jenny now that she's sat at home watching you take all the glory?
Not at all. No, as I completely understand where Jenny is. She's having, she's just had twins. Mm. You know, but yeah, maybe a little bit.
Do you know what? It's not like we've been doing Atomic Kitten for years and Jenny's left and Kez has come in.
True.
I mean, Atomic Kitten hasn't been a band for years. Yeah. You know, everyone kind of moved on. Jenny's got pregnant, so for her, that's a priority, which we understand.
Yeah, and this is the ultimate original lineup.
Yeah.
So we're happy about that. How long has it been since you girls performed on stage as, like, the three of you?
12 years.
Whoa!
12 years.
12 years. Mm. That's crazy. So are you excited to go back on stage and do it?
Yeah, we're very excited. But we're working hard towards it. You know, it's not something
are
that
we?
Are we? It's not something that we're going to take lightly, definitely, because we've got to, you know, get back into that mode again. Mm. It's different being in a band, you know, it's just...
I'm just having a fun. I just want to have a good time. I don't want to get too serious.
No.
Each second time around, it's like, God, you know, let's have a good laugh.
Yeah. So has this opportunity opened the doors for Atomic Kitten to come back and do any new material?
Absolutely. Yeah. We've been getting all kinds of offers, left, right and centre. Keep them coming in, you know. You know, we've got the world at our feet. Again, you know, we've been offered all kinds of stuff. Yeah. So it's quite exciting.
I mean, it is really, the world is our oyster right now. We can
pick and choose the best bits that we want
to
go
on and do.
And
the great thing now is the record company don't control us anymore.
You've got control.
We've got control, which is great.
So they say.
So to be continued as to what you girls are going to do, but it's exciting stuff.
Yeah, it's very exciting.
That's really cool. I don't know how you managed to do it, Kerry. She does everything under the sun. You're still like working.
I got me bankrupt. I've got over. Got bills to pay, love. Can't stand these two, really.
But it's great to have you girls back together, and it's great to talk to you today. It's been really, really fun. I've enjoyed it.